In tonight's Tax Insider, the state of the fiscal union. President Obama painted a picture of a robust U.S. economy with 14 million new jobs and the strongest 2 years of job growth since the 1990s. Unemployment is down to 5%. What's missing from this picture? For answers, I'm joined by David Williams, president of the Taxpayers Protection Alliance. Dave, the president says anyone who suggests the U.S. economy is in decline is peddling fiction. That might be a dig at GOP presidential candidate Donald Trump. Either way, you take issue with Obama's assessment. Why?
Thank you, Morris. Absolutely, we take exception. And what's missing is a little dose of reality here. Now, the president's job is to be optimistic. So when he goes to the State of the Union, he's not going to say the economy is in tatters and everything is awful. He's going to be optimistic. But let's look at some of the other numbers that he's not talking about. Yes, 5% unemployment. But real unemployment is at 10%. And when I say real unemployment, these are people that have stopped looking for a job, because the 5% does not take into account the folks that aren't looking for jobs anymore. And this ties in directly with the labor participation rate. Right now, it's at a low, not an all-time low, but it's pretty low at about 61%. To give some perspective on that, just a few years ago, maybe 10 years ago, it was about 67%. And what that means, not to get too technical with that term, basically people that are looking for a job and that have a job. So when it's low, that's not good. The higher the number, the better. So those are some warning signs, but also the poverty rate. We see the poverty rate at 46. We have 46.7 million people in poverty. That's up from 2007, before he took office. So yes, we are making strides in the economy, but there are warning signs out there. And Morris, here's my theory, is that we are one winter storm away from some awful economic numbers. We see this every year. Superstorm Sandy, we saw the economy tank after that. So one snowstorm or one really bad storm anywhere in the country really could have an adverse effect. And I think that's why the underpinnings of this economy are kind of weak. And the numbers look relatively good, but anything can happen.
And the inverse is true. With such a mild December, people weren't going to the stores and buying winter coats, and retail sales were taking
absolutely,
hit. All right, what role did tax reform play in the president's final State of the Union address?
Unfortunately, it didn't play a very big role. There was only lip service to tax reform, and that's frustrating, because this is something that Republicans and Democrats have been talking about. And Representative Lance Leonard from New Jersey said after the State of the Union, we want to work with the president on tax reform. So here's a Republican House member saying, Mr. President, let's talk about tax reform.
Dave, you're a president of sorts, so why don't you give us your own State of the Union, a State of the Union of tax reform. The mic is yours. What else do you have to say about the topic?
First and foremost, talk about individual reform and individual tax reform. Talk about how complicated the system is. Right now, the tax code is 4 million words. Now, keep that into perspective. The Bible is about 780,000 words. War and Peace, about 600,000 words. So, I mean, the tax code is very long, and it's very complicated for people. And it's complicated that we have 7 tax brackets. So reduce that to 3. Carly Fiorina, the presidential candidate, has talked about a 3-page tax code. I mean, that may not be doable, but I like where she's going with it. I mean, that's the point, is, you know, fewer pages is better.
Now, on Friday, open enrollment will close for insurance exchanges under the Affordable Care Act. The administration says 11.3 million people have signed up for coverage already. Young people make up about 35% of that group. Is it time to declare this law a success and move on?
It's really tough to declare this a success, because people lost coverage and then they signed up. So it's really tough to say that all these people signed up brand new, because a lot of people lost coverage. And we all remember, if you like your doctor, you can keep your doctor.
Right, remember
well,
that.
Well, that just wasn't true.
Didn't
so there's still a lot of problems with Obamacare and the premiums.
The last part, the premiums, you're paying more. Premiums are going up, too. All right.
They are, yeah, 6.5% this year, which is significant.
Now, your group is nonpartisan. Some people might view that as a political statement. Give us some numbers here.
Well, the healthcare co-ops, these are the co-ops that were set up as part of Obamacare to help people get health insurance in the various states. They're going bust, bankrupt, they're closing, and that's cost taxpayers $1.3 billion, the ones that have closed. All told, taxpayers have spent about $2.4 billion to create these co-ops and to put money into these co-ops. So we're talking about $1.3 billion lost to taxpayers. And that's money that taxpayers will never get back. And as we mentioned, the premiums are going up. Last year, it was a 5% increase. This year, as I mentioned, 6.5% increase. That is not making healthcare more affordable. And don't forget, Morris, we have the penalties. If you don't sign up for Obamacare, it could cost you thousands of dollars in penalties from the IRS.
That's a good point. All right, before you go, let's talk about the Powerball. The estimated jackpot is $1.5 billion. Bloomberg Business did a great breakdown of how taxes take a bite out of that payout. Nearly 40% goes to the federal government. Then you need to pay your state government. That amount varies from state to state. California and Pennsylvania don't tax lotto winnings. Oregon takes nearly 10%. Fascinating stuff here. What do you take away from it?
Well, it reminds me of the old adage, the house always wins when you gamble. And this is what happens with the government, is that they take a significant amount of the taxes. And all these wealth advisors say, take the lump sum and just get out of Dodge.
Right.
But it is going to cost, 40 to 45% in taxes. That's why I don't play, because I don't want to pay all these taxes. But, maybe this is a new technique to reduce the deficit. If we have enough lotteries in this country, maybe we can get rid of the deficit and pay down the debt.
Don't give anybody any ideas, because I can see that happening, too. Well, good luck to whoever wins, if there is a winner tonight. David Williams, president of the Nonpartisan Taxpayers Protection Alliance. Thanks, Dave.
Thank you.